cutting down of trees somewhere else in the world. Hemp is one crop that looks promising because it is a plant that is pretty resistant to a lot of diseases, and it grows well in the Netherlands. It can be used without using pesticides, and it doesn't need very special requirements with respect to soil nutrients. It needs some fertilizer, but not that much. Normally, hemp grows the best in some warmer climates than the type of climate that we have in Netherlands, but even in Netherlands, hemp is growing pretty fast.
The Dutch are proud of their perfect crop, 3 to 4 meters in height. Commercial hemp is also well established in France, where they have licensed farmers to grow strains that are almost drug-free.
L'utilisation papetière avait réellement débuté.
Cultivation for the purpose of papermaking really began around 1960. So now there are between 3,000 and 10,000 hectares. It is used to make special paper and in particular cigarette paper. In order to make this kind of paper, you need textile fibers that are very resilient. Hemp is one of the few plants in the world that contains fibers of a very high quality.
Et le chanvre est une des quelques plantes dans le monde qui comprennent des fibres de grande qualité.
The United Kingdom licensed commercial hemp in 1993 and is already producing a variety of hemp products, including this fine writing paper. In Australia, the Tasmanian government has allowed this experimental non-drug strain crop at the instigation of Patsy Harmson.
In Australia, we'd be very silly to let a crop like hemp go because it could solve a lot of our problems. One of our major problems is soil degradation, and just like in the old days when hemp was used to repair land after soil erosion, it could just as easily be used these days for repairing our own soil. It's a natural weed suppressant because of the way it grows. It grows on these tall, skinny stalks for good fibre, just with a thick canopy of leaves up above, and that just prevents anything underneath from being able to grow. The other beautiful thing about hemp is its long taproot, and the taproot binds the soil together. The nutrients in the hemp plant are concentrated in both the roots and the leaves and the flower head, and because if you're growing it for fibre you're only removing the stalk, the roots stay in the ground and the leaves and the flower heads are returned to the soil, which means that you're returning most of your nutrients. You're only removing cellulose and water if you're growing it for paper or textiles. Here in Australia we're virtually giving away our native forests at a price of, say, $70 to $80 a ton. Hemp, on the other hand, could be a wonderful replacement and would fetch $400 at least a ton.
Jim Young is one of the few voices in the US paper industry calling for change. He's the executive editor of Pulp and Paper magazine.
North America obviously has been blessed with an abundance of wood fiber, but the situation is changing now. We're coming to the end of the line on the virgin timber, and it's time to look at other sources of fiber to be used in the pulp and paper process here. And hemp is certainly one that should be considered for that use in future operations of our pulp and paper mills.
The federal government has recognized the need for finding alternatives to wood pulp because we're running out of trees. Way back in 1916, they published Bulletin 404 from the United States Department of Agriculture suggesting hemp as an alternative for wood pulp. They discovered that an acre of hemp would yield 4 times as much pulp as a wood fiber on a sustained yield basis. Not only that, the hemp can be grown anywhere. It grows like a weed, so that you could very easily supply the pulp mills with hemp and save the few trees that do remain to us for timber.
The textile industry is also experiencing a resurgence of interest in hemp.
The beauty of the hemp fibre is that it could be many things depending on its method of cultivation and the method of processing. These can range from coarse hessians, industrial fabrics such as carpet backings, to the finest linens. With special steam treatment, the fibre can fibrillate and produce a cloth of a silky consistency, which is indistinguishable from natural silk. It's limited only by your imagination and the technology that's been developed over hundreds of years. The fabrics that we're producing at the moment utilises either pure hemp or a blend of hemp and cotton. The jacket, for instance, that I'm wearing at the moment, 100% 11-ounce hemp linen, it has all the characteristics and appeal of a natural linen. Hemp is undoubtedly the most durable of the natural fibres. The original Levi jeans were made from recycled sailcloth, which was made from hemp fibre, and it proved its worth under the most trying of conditions. The testing we've done over 3 years, 3 years of very hard wash and wear, don't make the slightest impression on the hemp fibre. It softens, but it doesn't weaken. In terms of yield per acre, hemp probably outproduces cotton by at least 200%. And perhaps more under ideal conditions. Unlike cotton, hemp can be grown entirely without pesticides or insecticides.
The cotton industry is basically a chemical industry. It's highly dependent on the use of pesticides at all stages of production, right from the drilling of the seed through to the harvesting. That's pollution of air, water and soil, and eventually people. Cotton is the fourth largest export earner, foreign exchange earner in Australia. It's the heaviest user of pesticides of any rural industry. The cotton industry's got to change, and there's got to be alternatives. You've got to have different sorts of crop rotations, use of various sorts of other fibre crops, etc. So we do have this really, really big environmental problem that they don't want to recognise because of the business implications.
The technology is different for processing hemp, so obviously it would cost quite a lot to set up your hemp textile technology. But when you consider how easy it is to grow, how inexpensive it is to grow, because you don't have to pour money into chemicals, and you don't have to do a whole lot of repair work on humans that are getting sick from being in amongst the pesticides. When you consider all of those hidden costs, or pretty glaring costs actually, it's certainly going to be a far more beneficial crop, probably even in the short term.
Prior to 1937, 70 to 90% of all rope, twine and cordage was made from hemp. Hemp's strong fibres can also be utilised in hundreds of composite products. Henry Ford used hemp and other natural fibres to make the body of this car in 1941. William Condy has a redwood lumber business in Oregon. In the face of dwindling redwood supplies, his company has taken some bold steps to solve the problem.
We talk about advanced composites from annual fibers is the way to solve the forest crisis. Trees are fiber. That's what we cut them down for. But you take a Douglas fir tree, the longest fiber was 3/4 of an inch.